जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी गोपी जना वल्लभा गिरिवरदारी यशोदानंदन गजजन रंजन यशोदानंदन गजजन रंजन यशोदानंदन गजजन रंजन यमुना तीरावनकारी यमुना तीरावनकारी Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Rama Rama Hare Hare बालाजी की समावेत भक्त वृंद की कलयुग पावन हरिनाम संकीर्तन की ग्रंथराज श्रीमद्भागवतम की ओम ज्ञानति निरंदस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुः उन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवम् श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादि पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे नमो महावदन्याय कृष्ण प्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्ण चैतन्य नाम्ने गौरत्विषे नमः हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधो दीनबंधो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिका कांत राधा कांत नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी ऋषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृन्द हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमम् देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरये नष्टप्रायेष्व भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवतसेवया भगवत्युत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नन्दनाय च नन्दगोपकुमाराय गोविन्दाय नमो नमः Welcome all of you for the Krishna Rasayanam session on this beautiful Samudra Manthan Leela. In the previous class we devoted good amount of time in giving an introduction to this whole mood of the pastime and the lessons from the pastime. Almost I was discussing up to the end of this Leela. But now we are going in a little more detail. You can observe Lord Vishnu's speech to the demigods. He called all of them and he told them in verse number 18. Actually, last time I finished up to verse 24. 24 we are supposed to start today, but from 18 to 23 we will quickly again remind ourselves. You can go to verse number 18.
श्री भगवान वाच हंत ब्रह्मन अहो शंभो हे देवा मम भाषितम् श्रुणुतावहिताः सर्वे श्रेयो वः स्यात् यथा सुराः.
Read the translation please.
The supreme personality of God had said, O Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva and other demigods, please hear me with great attention, for what I say will bring good fortune for all of you.
Yeah, read the next translation also.
As long as you are not flourishing, you should make a truce with the demons and asuras who are now being favored by time.
Yeah. So here one important point here. Sometimes we are not favored by time. When you are not favored by time, one has to know how to act in an intelligent way by which one will be able to achieve one's goal. That will be explained in the next verse even more clearly with an example. Read the next translation.
O demigods, fulfilling one's own interests is so important that one may even have to make a truce with one's enemies. For the sake of one's self-interest, one has to act according to the logic of the snake and the mouse.
Yeah, I wanted to say a few words about the snake and mouse logic. Lord Vishnu is telling demigods, you are all like the snake and the demons are like the mouse. So once in this snake and mouse logic story, once a mouse and a snake both got trapped in a basket. So now the snake thought, if I eat the mouse, I can't come out of this place because later on the owner of the house will come and kill me. At the same time, if mouse can help me to make a hole, I can go out, save my life. So he requested the mouse, can you please help me make a hole? Both of us can escape out of the hole. We both are trapped here. But then mouse made the hole, the snake took advantage of the hole and went out, but before going out, he ate the mouse and then he went out. So Lord Vishnu said in the same manner, O demigods, you and the demons, both of you come on a truce and then do the Samudra Manthan, and then when the Amrita will come out, I will ensure you will get, and the demons should not get Amrita. Why? Because demons are the evil forces in the universe. If the evil forces are nourished and allowed to flourish, they will cause a great havoc in the universe. So as the saying goes, you know, one should not feed the feed bananas and milk to a snake, it is said. Payampanam bhujanganam kevalam vishavardhanam, it is said. So therefore, he said the demons should not drink Amrit. It is not good for them, because if they did that, if they ate that, then they will destroy the Brahminical culture in the whole creation. In fact, they will increase the atrocities and irreligion and all kinds of things which will actually act unfavorable to the living entities' forward progress back to Godhead. So Lord said, let them also help you in this truce. And then when Amrit comes, then you will get and they will not get. So like the snake ate the mouse, you can engage them to get the amrit. Now this may appear to be diplomatic or very cunning. Why is Lord Vishnu teaching this cunning logic? He is supposed to be equal to all. He is supposed to be kind to everyone. He is supposed to be supreme and innocent. All are his children. Some people may have such a question in your mind. Actually, this has a very great significance. A devotee of the Lord should certainly be innocent, but not naive. In English, there is a word called naive. Naive means gullible. Gullible means a devotee of the Lord is not a person who can be easily cheated by anybody. So there is a word called shrewd. The devotee is shrewd but not cunning. If I give you a few examples, this part will become very clear. One time, ISKCON had a bank account with the Punjab National Bank. So the Punjab National Bank had one counter within the ISKCON campus, one of our temples, you know, for helping the ISKCON with making all the, you know, balance sheet and calculation and putting money, taking out money, everything they were doing very well. So there was one proper disciple who was made in charge of account. So he was supposed to deal with them. So while dealing with them, he looked at the account and he showed it to the top manager and said, "Sir, see you guys, what nonsense you have done," like that he said. Because they had committed some mistake. So he said, "What nonsense you have done." So as soon as they heard the word nonsense, they got offended. They said, "What? You say we have done nonsense? Take it." So they gave the whole, accounting, money, all the work back to ISKCON. They said, "We were doing this work additionally as a service to you. Now that you are offending us, we don't want to do this work. Now you guys do it all and bring it to us." And that would take them weeks and months together of work. So the whole load came back on him. So Prabhupada said, our devotees are immature and foolish. They should know while dealing with karmis or non-devotees, you should respect them. If you don't respect them, then they may not do good to you, but they can be of nuisance value to you. They will add a nuisance to you. So similarly, for example, if some man is a fool, he's a muff, but he's a crorepati. He can do great work for Krishna. Sometimes you may see in this world that somebody may be a crorepati, but he may not have knowledge, but by will of providence, he's got money with him. So can a devotee go and tell him, "You are a muff, give money to Krishna service"? If you are so plain and straightforward, then he is going to get upset and his ego will be twisted and he will say, "Get lost, I won't give you a single penny." Correct, no? So Prabhupada said, when you are meeting even a fool or a muff, you should actually understand that he has some opulence which Krishna has given him, which is wealth, which could be utilized in Krishna service. So there is nothing wrong in appreciating him or praising him. That, you know, you are such a punyavan. Because you are a punyavan, God has given you so much wealth. Not only you have wealth, you are also eager to serve the Lord. You wish to make a temple for the Lord, or you want to serve. And that's what Vamanadeva did. If you see Vamanadeva, when he went to ask Bali Maharaj for some charity, in the beginning you will see, he glorified Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha. Do you know that? He said, "Oh Bali, you are coming in the lineage of such great and mighty powerful kings like Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu. Even Lord Vishnu had to flee for his life." They were so mighty and powerful, they were ruling the whole world. Like that he spoke. Vamanadeva. Actually, Vamanadeva is same as Vishnu only. He is talking to him like this. So, it's not wrong for a devotee to appreciate and glorify one who gives charity. In fact, Lord Vamanadeva spoke in a way that Bali was inspired to give charity of 3 steps of land. So, is it diplomacy or is it cunningness? No, you can't call it cunningness or diplomacy. Why? There are 2 aspects involved here. One should be intelligent to engage everybody in Krishna service. While engaging in Krishna service, appreciation, adoration, encouragement is certainly not diplomacy. And also, if you want to protect Krishna's movement, we have to be shrewd and intelligent. If you are naive and gullible or easily cheatable, then we will get cheated very easily. Devotee requires intelligence in protecting Krishna's moment. Another example I'll tell you. When Prabhupada was once coming into a country through the customs, at that time, Prabhupada's servant was also with him. So the customs people asked, there is a rule that, you know, people should carry some yellow fever certificate because they didn't want them to spread the yellow fever to other people. So they asked Prabhupada, Swamiji, do you have a yellow fever certificate? So the servant got very angry, annoyed. He said, what? Srila Prabhupada is a Jagadguru. He is a founder acharya of our society. And he is completely transcendental. How can you ask such a person, do you have a yellow fever certificate? Mind your words, and something like that, he shouted. So they became very angry also. They said, no, we are doing our duty. And you people are not decent. So they said, put the Swamiji in quarantine. He said, quarantine means they have a place, it's like a house arrest kind of thing. You put a person in a place for one full day, he has to wait. So they put him on wait for one full day. And Prabhupada told the servant, just see, because of your immature behavior, I have wasted my one day of preaching. And again, the Prabhupada said the same point. When you are dealing with non-devotees, one has to be respectful, polite and well-behaved, gentle. And unnecessarily, one should not hurt their ego, he said. All through the Vaishnava literatures, you will find Vaishnavas behaving very maturely and shrewdly. Example of Raghunath Das. When Raghunath Das' father, Govardhan Majumdar, and his uncle, Hiranya Majumdar, you know, you will find they both actually were leading the whole Hindu community in those days. And they would collect all the taxes and then give it to the Muslim king. So one time, they were actually collecting almost 1.5 times of what was to be given to the king. And they gave only one part to the king and half part they kept with themselves. So for, of course, serving the Hindu community. But this was, one of the king's man came to know. And the king, and he actually came to meet Govardhan Majumdar, Hiranya Majumdar. He came to meet him. So when he came there, they both came to know he is coming. So they went away. Just like sometimes you go for income tax raid or something to somebody's place. So when he came, at that time Raghunath Das was there. What officer who came? One of the officers who came to asking for the money. You know what he told? See, your father and uncle are making so much money. If they give something for my pocket, then I will not interfere with them. Something to that effect, he said. So Raghunath Das was so well behaved. He said, oh, sir, you are like my father. You know, after he spoke in such a sweet way, that fellow who came to collect tax, his heart completely melted. So he came in angry mood, but he went back in a happy mood by the good behavior of Raghunath Das. Something similar you find with Sanatan also. Sanatan Goswami tells Mahaprabhu that, you know, I am a fool, I have no knowledge. But when he was put in the jail, Sanatan and Rup Sanatan, they both were coming from Gaud Sarasat Brahman family from Karnataka. But they were migrated to Bengal. So one time Nawab Hussain Shah came to know that amongst the Hindu people, these two are like leaders, very intelligent fellows. So he called for them and said, I want to make you finance minister and home minister. You take up this post, and if you refuse, then I will torture the Hindus. So they were in two minds. Why should we work under a Mughal king? You know, they're all eating cow flesh and everything. Why should we work under them? They didn't want to work. But then considering the welfare of the Hindu community, they agreed to work. So they were given an honorary title, Dabir Khas and Sakar Malik, given like the Mughals, the Muslims wear the topi and the beard. All that was honored on them, given to them. So, but then Rup Sanatan's heart was not there. Their heart was with Lord Chaitanya. So behind their palace, like we had gone to this place where Rup Sanatan had their palace. Even today the palace ruins are there. You can see that. When we went to Ramkeli, at that time we went to that place also. We saw that palace. Some of the walls of the palace are still there. Some rooms are still there. So Rupa and Sanatan had a big palace. And behind their palace, they made a Gupta Vrindavan, Vrindavan type of forest they had made with all Radha Kund, Sham Kund, Govardhan, everything, so that they can go there and meditate and chant and study the scriptures and all. But then, at one point of time, they got fed up with this job. Rupa Goswami told his brother, Sanatan, that I will go ahead, and then I am leaving a boatload of gold coins for you, which may help you, and then you also come back later on. So he went ahead. So Sanatan was in the Sanatan was not doing the government service, and Nawab Zinshah became angry. At one time, he put him in the jail. So, from the jail, how Sanatan escaped, if you see, he was very intelligent. He had some gold coins with him. He told the jail keeper, who had a long beard, he told him, "Sir, can you please kindly allow me to go to Mecca?" He said. So, and then he said, "Which religious person in this world will stop any child of God to go to Mecca and Medina and do the religious duties?" So, and then he said, "You are like my father. Please kindly permit me, I can perfect my life." So the Muslim jail keeper started weeping practically. He had tears flowing from his eyes, going through his beard. Either it is said, he melted his heart by his sweet speech. But then the fellow said, "But if I let you go, the king will come back and become angry on me and he'll behead me." And then Sanatan said, "Don't worry. Tell him that I wanted to pass tool and you allowed me to go to the riverside along with my handcuffed chains and, you know, chains in my legs. But then in the name of passing through, I rolled into the river and I got drowned in the river." You can say like that. And then he said, "Oh, that's a good idea." And then he said, "Okay, let me think about it." Sanatan said, "Don't think. Take this gold coin." He gave a big number of gold coins. The gold coins were shining in his face and he became attracted, and then he opened the gate, and then Sanatan ran to Vrindavan and met Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and surrendered his life. So you will see, our acharyas have been very intelligent, very shrewd in terms of not wasting their human form of life. So Sanatan, you can imagine, after Rupa Goswami went, if Sanatan was in the jail all his life, you know, he would not have been able to do what Lord Mahachaitanya Mahaprabhu wanted him to do. So, but you will see, Rup, Sanatan and other Goswamis never used diplomacy or cheating while dealing with Vaishnavas. So therefore we should know, here Lord Vishnu himself is teaching to the demigods that you have to be shrewd, you have to be intelligent. If you are not in this material world, people are very demoniac, very crooked, and they can pose trouble to you. Like last December, Lalit Madhupu, myself and one or two more devotees, we went to Market Yard. In Market Yard, we put a table, book table, and we displayed the books. And just at a stone's throw from there was a shop, some newspaper and cinema magazines shop. So that fellow came running to us and said, "Hey, you cannot put the table here, get out," he said. Immediately, our two of the devotees got very frightened. They were actually begging him, "Sir, sir, please, we will not disturb your shop. Your shop is there, we are here." He said, "No, nothing doing, get out." Like that he was telling, very strongly. Then Lalit Mahaprabhu was taking the books from the van. So he came and told the gentleman, "Wait a minute, how can you drive us out? Here is a letter, we have taken a permission for this book marathon month. We have got official permission." And that fellow said, "No, I don't want all this permission. You cannot put here. My business is getting affected," he was selling. Because his cinema magazines were not selling, our Gita was selling. That was his problem. And then I was there. I told that fellow, "See, we are not putting this table throughout the year. We are only putting 1 month in a year." So I agree that some little business may be affected. In fact, even you should take a Bhagavad Gita also. See, this is God's words. People are anyway reading cinema magazine and getting their life ruined. At least in this 1 month, let them, Gita Jayanti month, let them take it. Still he was yelling and shouting. But I appreciated Lalit Madhupu, who was very firm and very bold. He categorically told him, "Jo karna karo. You bring whomever you want. You bring. We will not move out of this place. You bring police, you bring traffic policeman. Because we have a letter. We can show the letter that we have taken permission." Then that man understood, "Arey, in this team one strong fellow is also there." Then he kept mum. Then he went back and, you know, After that, he never came. So why I am telling you this example, we should know that we should be humble, simple, polite, well-behaved, tolerant, and everything is patient and everything. But sometimes for Krishna's cause, if somebody is trying to cheat Krishna, then one should not allow it. Cheat Krishna or Krishna's movement. One has to defend Krishna's movement. So individually and collectively, our movement has to be protected. And we can't afford to get cheated by the non-devotee karmis who are very diplomatic and very cunning. Actually, in this pastime, the demons actually had a plan. Their plan was, demigods are weak, we are strong. So when there is going to be a Samudra Manthan, when Amrit comes, because we are strong, we will just drive them away. And we will take all the Amrit and we will drink. That was the plan of demons. But Lord Vishnu said, I know very well what is the plan of demons. He said, but you guys will get the Amritam because you are following Lord Vishnu's order and following the Brahminical culture. Therefore, you deserve to get the Amritam. Another thing we can learn from this is, with respect to dealing with demons, you know very well that demons are selfish, demons are cruel, demons have a cheating mentality, and we should not get cheated. That was one lesson we learned till now. But one more lesson to be learned, even if you are working with devotees, even if you are working with pious people also, those people who are in this material world, to some degree or other, they are selfish. It's a very painful thing for us to know that in this world, nobody will want to work for you unless they have some gain while working for you. Can any of you say that you go to company because you love your boss very much? You don't need any salary. Can you say that? Everybody works in a company because you get your part and they get their part. They're selfish. Therefore, whenever we collaborate with anybody, the first thing we should think is, you know, what is the other person going to get also? You know, then only they will collaborate. Otherwise, if you tell the other person, if you collaborate with me, I will get this, I will get that, he will say, okay, you will get all this, what will I get? They will have that question. Therefore, Lord Vishnu taught that when you are going for a collaboration with the demons, actually one has to know that both of you will do the churning of the milk ocean, and then the result is Amritam will come, and we can share and enjoy. That's what the demigods told. But the demons had a different idea. Actually, demigods seriously thought we are going to share and enjoy. Demigods were thinking. But then the demons had a very different idea. They wanted to cheat the demigods and take away all the Amritam, which they did actually in the beginning. They took away the Amrit collection, ran away. And then Lord Dhanvantri watched it all. And then he expanded himself into Mohini Murti. And then brought the Amritam back to the demigods. But as it is said here, one should know how not to get cheated. For example, there was one devotee in his early days, he was chanting 4 rounds. So he comes from a very pious family and he said in his life he has never spoken lie. So he will never speak lie. So his friends would come and call him for a movie. So he would honestly tell them, see, I want to become Krishna conscious. So I don't want to come for a movie because movie will make me Maya conscious. Do you think friends are going to take him seriously? Hey, they said, come on, you are speaking a different language nowadays. In order to have a little change of mindset, come with us. Come and watch the movie. So they, 4 or 5 friends literally dragged him, took him to the movie. So that day he didn't come to the class. We used to have Saturday class, he didn't come. So later on Monday, Tuesday we met him. And he said, my friends dragged me and took me to movie. It was a dirty movie, I never wanted to watch. Then we told him, you could have told them a lie, you know, that you have dysentery or something. If you say you have dysentery, nobody can call you anywhere. Because you have to stay near the bathroom only. Isn't it? But he was not ready to tell the lie. Result, he had to leave Krishna consciousness. Gradually he got lost along with Maya's friends. So therefore, if you are a devotee, we should know how to deal with people in such a way. For example, if a husband, wife, children, all are living in a home. Say, for example, there was one Mataji who would get up in the morning at 5 o'clock, take a bath, and she would be chanting Hare Krishna. 2 hours, she would chant. And she told all family members, unless I complete my rounds, I will not begin any work, cooking or anything. So the husband would be cutting sabji, making the things ready for her to cook. And then royally she would come and put the things in the this thing. So the children were also very annoyed. Generally children expect that the mother will come and greet us when we get up in the morning. Otherwise children get up in the morning and they start crying also. You can see that. So she was not available for the children, not for the husband, not for the in-laws. Gradually she brought great bad name to ISKCON, bad name to Prabhupada. Eventually the family became like a Kurukshetra. Big quarrel, big fight inside the home. So a woman has to be very intelligent also. Like she gets up in the morning, you know, she does her cooking, everything, and then there is a time when she sends off the children to school, sends her husband to office. Then there is a time she gets for herself. She has a time. Especially if her husband is not a devotee, in front of him you wear a big tilak and chest with a bead bag, that itself will irritate that fellow. Immediately if you sit like this. Isn't it? So one requires some shrewdness, not to irritate people who don't like certain things. Again and again, you do the same thing what people don't like, immediately you will find the whole thing becomes very acidic. So what is the meaning of shrewdness? Shrewdness means to know when to do what, how to speak, how to act in certain situations. Narada Muni tells in 7th canto, 14th chapter, in Civilized Human Beings, in that chapter, he says, if you become a devotee, he says, all your relatives will surround you. And they all are going to tell you, especially in functions like marriages and all, they will come and tell you that, you see, your cousin brother has gone to America. He is making so much money. You can invest money in this, you can invest money in that. If you do that business, you can make more money. Why they are telling you? Because it's likely that your mother, father must have cried to the relatives that my son has become Krishna conscious now. You know, my son or daughter has become Krishna conscious. Because of that, they are not economically developing. Please give some upadesh, give some advice to them. Then all relatives surround you and give a lot of advice to you. And generally what do? We argue. We tell them that, you know, no, wait a minute. If I run after money, then how will I get Krishna in my life? You may say that. They will say, who said you should not get Krishna? After becoming 80 or 90, you can get Krishna. This is not the age. You are now 25, 30. This is time to work. And then they will give hundreds of examples. See, this fellow has become this, he has become that, your cousin, your this, that, everything. And they will completely, you know, make you totally different than before. Afterwards, you will give up your Krishna consciousness. So what Narada Muni says, if relatives and friends surround you and tell you how to multiply your money, you should nod the head very fastly. Like this. Like there is a tanjur bull, you know that? This tanjur bull, if you play tan-tan, tan-tan, it will nod the head. Like that, very fastly it will nod. But the tanjur bull's nodding the head has no meaning. Similarly, Narada Muni tells, when your relatives ask you to do different nice things to become more economically developed, just nod the head. But after they go away, you follow the guru. Whatever guru says, you follow, he says. Because guru teaches you how to go back to Godhead. Materialistic relatives teach you how to go to hell. So if you really are interested in going back to Godhead, you should follow the order of the guru. Guru will tell you to simplify your material life. And he will tell you to pay attention to spiritual life. And it may be a little confusing, bewildering to you in the beginning. You may think, oh, all my friends are all making so much money. Many of my friends have got so many houses. They have so many this thing, that thing. Mind may be pulling us in a material direction, but Guru is pulling us in a spiritual direction. And if you faithfully follow Guru, you get Krishna. You get carried away by the current of material relatives, false advices, you will simply go down to hell. We don't get any benefit by that. So you require shrewdness there also. One requires intelligence. So therefore, if your goal is to become Krishna conscious, it is not enough to be innocent. It is not enough to be simple. It is also important to be intelligent. Therefore, Prabhupada gave the definition. Utsaha means, anybody knows the definition Prabhupada gives in Nectar of Instruction? Utsaha means, yes, endeavoring with intelligence. He said, not just mindless endeavor. Endeavoring with intelligence. So we should know where to put the endeavor. We should not make futile endeavors. So that intelligence includes acting according to TPC, we call it time, place, circumstance. One should know how to act in which place. Actually, one should know while dealing with non-devotees or with semi-devotees, one should know what is their interest and act in such a way that without affecting our Krishna consciousness, one should try to please them. Without affecting our Krishna consciousness, we should defend and protect our Krishna consciousness. And then as much as we can extend to their request, we can. That's what we should do. Similarly, here also the Lord taught the demigods about this. Then text number 21.
Amrutotpadane yatnaha kriyatam avilambitam yasya pitasya vaijantur mrityugrasto maro bhavet.
Immediately endeavor to produce nectar, which a person who is about to die may drink to become immortal.
Yeah. And then the Lord told demigods the next verse, cast into the ocean of milk all kinds of vegetables, grass, creepers, drugs, and these are all jadi buti, we say, no? Medicinal herbs and everything. And then with my help, making Mandara Mountain the churning rod and Vasuki the rope for churning, churn the ocean of milk. With undiverted attention. That's what the Lord says. So, which means, how is Amritam made? When these vegetables, grass, creepers, drugs, they are all put and they are churned along with milk, then that process actually produces Amritam. This is actually the process, which means Amritam also has medicinal value. It has the ability to increase the ayu, increase the duration of life. Lord is teaching them the process, what is to be done. Thus the demons will be engaged in labor, but you, the demigods, will gain the actual result, the nectar produced from the ocean. So, now the Lord is going to give another very important instruction which we read and we didn't discuss much. Text number 24.
Yuyam tat anumodadvam yadichanti asurah suraha na samrambhena siddhyanti sarvartha santvaya yatha.
Yeah.
My dear demigods, with patience and peace, everything can be done. But if one is agitated by anger, the goal is not achieved. Therefore, whatever the demons ask, agree to their proposal.
Yeah. So there are three very important qualities: enthusiasm, patience, and determination required for accomplishing any goal, material or spiritual goal. And if you are not patient, you know, we will spoil the show. Generally, when we are not patient, we become impatient. Impatience leads to anger. Anger, agitation, disturbance. And naturally, we, like yesterday, I had gone for one of the Bhagavatam distribution programs. So there was one mata who had brought her son also. So she was telling me, Swamiji, please tell my son to study well. He's always playing all day. Then I told that mata that, you know, from the way you are asking me, I can tell you have enough told him to study. Understand? Huh? She was so forceful. I told her, I don't want to do the same thing with your son. I said, I will tell him to chant Hare Krishna, by which he will get concentration in his studies. So I told the boy, okay, you chant Hare Krishna, I told him. So sometimes, when we are impatient, we have a habit of repeating the same thing over and over again. And that person eventually shows deaf ears. They will not listen. Another thing, when we are impatient, we become angry. We get extremely upset and extremely angry, and that anger affects the emotional chemistry of the other person, and that person becomes adamant not to do what we want. It becomes counterproductive also. Another aspect of impatience is it causes agitation of mind. Within our own mind, we become restless, because we are fruitive. Fruitive means we want to get something from the person which the person is not giving. So we become very impatient, and that anger causes, inner chemistry of our own system get affected, and we get diseases. We get mental diseases, we get restlessness, we get lack of sleep, insomnia. Sometimes we may be crying ourselves. Sometimes we may be fuming inside. These are all due to impatience. So Prabhupada gives the example, if a girl gets married to a man, there has to be some period of time when she can get a child. It's not that today you got married, next day morning you get a baby. You can't get like that. There is some time involved. First she serves him, pleases him, then there is a union, then it takes some 9 months for the child to come. Correct, no? One requires patience. So in the same manner, any good thing you want to do materially, spiritually, we need patience. Now, Amrita Manthan also is not an ordinary thing. Lord Vishnu has brought demons and demigods together on a truce to do the Samudra Manthan. But Lord says that, you have to be patient till the Amritam comes. You can't be hasty. And generally what happens with us, when we face some difficulty, people want solution quick or slow. People want quick solution. They have instant idlis. They have instant gulab jamun. They want instant solution also. Einstein made one very meaningful statement. He said, the intelligence with which human beings created the problem is not enough to solve those problems. Like that he said. For example, you require some intelligence to create a damage, but you require another type of intelligence to repair the damage. That is higher intelligence. For example, a child can take a pot and then break it. That requires one type of intelligence. Little bit you need energy to break it. But can the child make the pot? He cannot make. That's what Einstein said. He said man has created a lot of damage all across the globe to environment, to one another, by creating bombs and creating a terrorism situation for each other. But he said you can't solve it with your material science. He clearly said that. You require spiritual science to solve the material problems. So we had one full chapter in our Essence of Bhagavad Gita in those days. Material problems, spiritual solutions. So you have to solve it using... Like therefore nowadays many, many people are interested in studying about the mind, nature of mind, and nature of habits, and good health, relationships. These are all very important topics nowadays. People want to know how to cultivate good relationships with others, how to have good health through vegetarianism, how to have a peaceful mind, how to experience happiness. These are all becoming very important, which is not available in material science. Material science cannot provide these things. Material science can teach you how to create a bomb and throw. Can destroy somebody. Throw it in Hiroshima, Nagasaki. That is taught. Or science can give you a guillotine machine where you can kill millions of cows in a very short time. Such kinds of things science can provide. Science cannot provide peace. Science provides violence. So you will see, generally scientific developments happen when two countries are in war, like World War I, World War II. Quickly, many new bombs are invented at that time. Scuds and missiles are invented. So science can create violence, but you need a spirituality to bring about peace and bliss and happiness. So Lord also told the demigods that you need patience. You have to, like Prabhupada gave an example. Say you have a gold ring. You went to drink water in a pond. As you put your hand, the ring slipped out of your finger. It was a little loose ring. It slipped and fell into the water. So you may get worried because the ring is some 5 lakh rupees or something. You may just move the water like this. Where is my ring? Will you find it? Prabhupada said, you can't find it. Prabhupada said, just sit back and chant, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Complete one round, then you'll find the ring. Why? Because the pond will settle. When the pond settles completely, becomes calm and serene, then you will see the ring. Slowly put your hand and pick the ring. Take it out very carefully. But if you become impatient, You splash the water, where is my ring? Where is my ring? You will not find it. Similarly, our mind becomes very cluttered when we become impatient. Mind becomes cluttered and we become confused, bewildered, and we yell and shout and scream. In Tamil, there is a saying, when you are angry, you may have a big vessel with this much big size mouth. It may be big and you want to find the mug. Where is the mug? Your hand is not even entering that big vessel because you are so angry, it is said. So, any of you had experience, in angry mood you were searching for something, you couldn't find it. Like for example, so I am keeping like this, oh, where is my specs? Everywhere I will be searching. But later on, if you go and see in a mirror, I will find it here. So, therefore the Lord said, don't lose your patience. With patience and peace, everything can be done. For example, when we see, for example, a parent is seeing a child not following a particular value, they should not immediately try to teach that value to the child. Like one father was seeing that his son, small boy, was playing with toys. The neighborhood boy came and he asked, can you please give me a toy? And child said, hey, get lost, I cannot give you. And the father was watching it. He thought, how can my son behave like this? So he went to the son and said, hey, beta, at least give one toy to that boy. And the child said, no, I won't give, he said. And then the father thought, how to teach this value of sharing with others? I want to teach this. Then the father took out a lollipop and said, hey, beta, I will give you this lollipop if you give one toy to the child. And the son said, no, I don't want lollipop. I will not give, he said. Then the father was very upset. Then what to do? Then he went to the boy and said, at least one you should give. You have got four or five. Which one you want to give? Tell me, I will give it to him, like the father said. And son said, none of it. I will not give any of them. Then the father said, you will not give any? No, I will give. So father snatched it from him and gave it to the child. And the neighbor child took it and went. And this boy started crying very loudly. Now what happens in such a behavior? You may think that I have taught my son not to be attached to everything and he should share. Do you think the child is going to learn the sharing? He will not learn very easily. Rather, he develops a very great enmity by that. Before. So, certain values, if you want to inculcate in people, you have to watch first and then teach later. That is also patience. For example, if the boy is not giving a toy, okay, you later on take the boy to a park or somewhere, you buy some four or five lollipops and make him share some of the lollipops to the beggar children. Okay, give this to one to each of the beggar. Slowly it can be taught, because like you see, when you put a plant and you water it, can you expect the plant to grow very fast? Can it give flowers and fruits within a day or two? It takes time. Similarly, inculcating values in children or people in our care is not a very easy thing. Overnight, we cannot do that. Patience is required. And if you are angry and impatient, many times, you know, things don't happen. They develop animosity on one hand. On the other hand, they have not learned the value. So, neither they do they learn the value. On the other hand, they develop animosity also. It doesn't serve the purpose. So, therefore, the Lord told here, Lord is telling, Yuyam tat anumodadvam yadichanti asura suraha na samrambhena siddhyanti sarvartha santvaya yatha. My dear demigods, with patience and peace, everything can be done. But if one is agitated by anger, the goal is not achieved. Therefore, whatever the demons ask, agree to their proposal, the Lord said. See, especially if it comes from somebody like the Supreme Lord, then one should close your eyes and follow it. Because when, why they are saying what they are saying, you cannot understand with your little intelligence. Lord knows better. Lord knows better. Actually, you will see that those who have already got worldly experience for many years, Sometimes due to their maturity in the material world, they know how to do things. But the younger ones oftentimes are short-sighted. They generally think only this much. They don't think long-term. So Lord is actually thinking of a long-term benefit for the demigods and telling them, you know, if you are going to chase after the petty gifts, then you will lose the bigger gift. So you have the choice. You want the biggest gift or the petty gifts? So that choice is yours. Say, for example, say you go to a very big mela, a fair, and at the entrance they give you a sack and tell you, you can take anything here you want, but you will only be allowed to take one full sack. And once the sack is full, you will be asked to go out. You have to go out with that sack. But anything you want to pick up, you can pick up. Correct, no? So you go inside and you find a lot of potatoes. You fill up your sack with potatoes. And then you go a little inside. You find a lot of pens. You find a lot of notebooks. And you are filling up your sack. Suddenly in one place you find a lot of gold coins you find. What you will do? You will throw everything out of your sack. You will empty it. And then you will fill it up with gold coins. And that's what we should do. When you get Amritam, then all other gifts can be thrown away. Smaller gifts. So the Lord said, don't be attracted by petty things. Be attracted to the biggest gift. Similarly, in our life also, the Amritam is compared to Krishna Prem. But unfortunately, what happens, before we achieve Krishna Prem, we become greedy to fill up our sack with so many petty gifts. And by the time we come to receive Amritam, we are already stuck in these gifts only. Earlier gifts, useless gifts, petty gifts, good-for-nothing gifts. They are the ones which we possess. For example, even those who become devotees, they can actually become ISKCON devotees also. Sometimes they can get carried away by very attractive jobs paying very big salaries. They can become attracted to making big houses. They can become attracted to foreign opportunities. They can become attracted to becoming big achievers and accomplishers in material life. Likely that they may have some great intelligence in some field, but if that is becoming a stumbling block in developing Krishna Prem, what is the use of that? Like Ramananda Rai was a governor of Madras. He was a Shudra, he was governor of Madras. But his governor post did not come in the way of his fully blossoming Krishna consciousness. You can take Pratapurudra king. Did his kingship become a stumbling block for him in developing his Krishna consciousness? It didn't become. Is it not true? Then nothing wrong in being a king. You can be IAS officer and be like Ramananda Rai. Isn't it? No problem. But if our great goal, material goals, they completely occupy our mind and they become a stumbling block in our blossoming Krishna consciousness, then Shramayeva hi kevalam, Bhagavatam says that. It's good for nothing. So, therefore, we should be careful not to be foolish to pick up the petty gifts of this world. There is a saying in Bible by Jesus. He says, do not strive for wealth which will be stolen by thieves, or the property which will be eaten by moths or rusted by wind. Like that he says. Stolen by thieves, eaten by moths, rusted by wind. Now, stolen by thieves means money. And eaten by moths means the beams and all you make in house where the termite eats inside. Having a big house with big beam. Like that, yeah. Stolen by thieves, eaten by moths. Rusted by wind means, you know, the iron becomes rusted by wind. Similarly, one may have a very big structure of a house or money or things like that. So he says that in this world, if one wants to become a material hero, then he becomes forgetful of Krishna. So Prabhupada says in Puranjana Upakhyan, there are two heroes in this world, material hero, spiritual hero. Spiritual hero is one who controls the senses and mind and directs it in Krishna's service. Material hero, you know, thinks he is a hero, but he is a slave of his senses. And in this world he achieves big, big things. At the time of death he has nothing to carry with him. He is empty-handed. So material hero becomes a zero at the time of death. So, therefore, the Lord told them that right now you all are participating in this project of Samudra Manthan. many gifts are going to come. But Lord told them, whatever the demons ask, agree to their proposal, Lord said. Although you may be upset by seeing them picking up small gifts, Lord said, I am going to give you the biggest gift of Amritam. So just let the demons take whatever they want. You don't become angry with them. Like that the Lord said. Next verse he says,
Na bhetavyam kalakutat vishat jaladhi sambhavat lobah karyo na vojatu roshah kamastu vastushu.
See, four things the Lord is telling them. Na bhetavyam, do not be afraid, he is saying. Of what? Kalakotar. A poison is going to come when you all will be doing this Samudra Manthan. But do not worry, I will arrange somebody. Who is that somebody? Lord Shiva. To drink away, take away that poison. In this way, in our life also, sometimes we start good projects. But when there are difficulties, we drop the project and quit. For example, one good project is to increase the rounds. Some people increase the rounds to 12 or 16 rounds. Suddenly, when some crisis comes in family, they drop down to 0 or 1. You can see that. And generally people, whenever difficulties come in life, where do people generally compromise? Spiritual life. They may have 25 things, but the only one thing that will that their mind will tell them is, oh, this Krishna consciousness is becoming a big headache. So I have no time to read now. I have no time to chant now. I have no time to go to temple. I have no time to go to weekly program. Those are the things they will compromise. And their material program will go on. Now, do you think they stop eating? Do you think they stop sleeping? Do you think they stop responding to their WhatsApp messages? They have time for all that. But they always compromise on Krishna consciousness. So therefore, Lord is telling, never quit Krishna consciousness. If you quit Krishna consciousness, you are quitting relation with Krishna. So, na bhetavyam kalakutar. In families, sometimes suddenly financial crunch comes. In one family, some money was stolen. Some 10, 20 lakh rupees was stolen. So they stopped coming to temple. Actually, the mistake was they had not properly locked the house. They lost the money. Now after losing money, they thought, now we have lost the money. Now we have to make the money now. So then they blooped from Krishna consciousness, you see. Or sometimes there is a health crisis at home. Somebody got cancer, somebody got some big disease, then people immediately compromise on devotional service. So there can be small and big crises which can come in our lives. Therefore the word is used, aghaituki apratihata. Apratihata means there should be no interruption in our devotional service. It should be non-stop, continuous, like a Ganga flowing towards the ocean. We should never stop anywhere. Or we should never become dull. Or which never become frightened. Sometimes what happens to a devotee, they advance for some time in spiritual life. Suddenly they develop a feeling that, spiritual life is becoming too difficult. Chanting is very difficult. Four regulative principles are very difficult. I think I need a little rest now. I need a little sense gratification I need now. I need a break now. Like that one feels. And then when they take a break, and that is the time, you know, Maya captures them by the neck and takes them headlong in the other opposite direction. And then again for them to come back to Krishna consciousness will be very difficult. I remember in those days there was one devotee who stopped chanting. He was a 16-rounder, initiated devotee and all that. So when he stopped, after 3-4 years he wanted to revive the chanting. He couldn't. So once when I met, he was telling, Bhaji, please give my sadhana back. He was telling, I want my sadhana back. I said, who said you cannot do chanting? I am not going to give you. You have to take the beta bag and chant. Isn't it? But once you give up the good practices, again to get back to them is not very easy. Which is easy? You know, loosening is easy or tightening is easy? Loosening is easy. Once you get loose, then to tighten it is very difficult afterwards. Similarly, good spiritual practices should never be given up out of fear that, this is too much, I can't do this, I can't do that.
So Lord told, don't quit the project and go away. It is my project. I am giving you that you should do the Samudra Manthan. So once you take the Guru's instructions very seriously, Krishna's instruction, Guru's instruction, once we have received it, if we claim that we love them, then we have to follow them. Otherwise our love has no meaning. Then our love is called sentimental. Sometimes we like a person, but we don't like his instructions. That means our love is sentimental love. Like there are people who tell me, Prabhu, please come to our home, please talk to us. Then I ask, can I give a lecture? Lecture we don't want. Then what will I talk? All I know is to tell you something good about what Krishna is saying. There are people who just want to keep a photo of a person, meet a person, get some affection from the person without hearing the instruction and following it in their lives. So Lord Vishnu said, if you claim that you really love me, you have to follow me. But how do you follow me? Don't quit. Don't give up the spiritual practices. Don't compromise. You see, if you don't shave, this beard and mustache and hair keeps growing, correct, no? So that is compared to the material desire. Material desire, we have to keep on shaving regularly. If you don't shave, they will keep growing, we have to keep shaving. It's not that once you removed material desire, it went away. Some of you can appreciate this point. Some material desire we had, it went away. Now it's again revisiting. You have seen that experience? It is not that material desires are gone forever. They can again be revived. They may come again. So therefore, we have to, he says, never quit. No matter how difficult it is, take help and go on in spiritual life. Take guidance, take help. There may be very blissful times in spiritual life. There may be some difficult times. But a devotee never gives up. Even in difficult times also, a devotee continues. Just like the gopis, Krishna went out of Vrindavan at the age of 11 years or so. And gopis anticipated he'll come back. But Krishna never came for a long time. And then when Krishna was 125 years old, the gopis and the Vrijavasis saw him in Kurukshetra. There is a place called Radha Krishna Milan Mandir. So, not that they gave up devotional service because Krishna went away out of Vrindavan. They continued devotional service, even in his absence also. Like for example, when Prabhupada was here in the planet till 1977, many people loved him. When Prabhupada left the planet, they also gave up devotional service. So what does that mean? That means their love was very superficial and sentimental, isn't it? But there are other Prabhupada disciples who for the last 50 years, they are having the same enthusiasm what they had when Prabhupada was in the planet. What about that? That means they have learned the art of serving the Vani of Prabhupada. Serving the instructions of Prabhupada. They are feeling Prabhupada's presence even now by faithfully serving his instruction. So there is a very nice saying, the spiritual master lives in his sound vibration and the follower lives with him. So he lives in his sound vibration. So a disciple may be far away from the Guru or a disciple may be bereft of the association of Guru. Still the disciple continues to strictly adhere to the instruction and never gives up. Because he always thinks, what will my Guru think? What will Prabhupada think if I give up and go away? I have to hold on to the lotus feet and continue. Na petavyam kala kota, he says. Vishadjalism. And then he says, lobakaryo, he is saying. Please read the translation.
A poison known as kala kota will be generated from the ocean of milk. But you should not fear it. And when various products are churned from the ocean, you should not be greedy for them or anxious to obtain them, nor should you be angry.
Lord told them you should be patient, you should not be angry, now you should not be afraid, and now he's telling you should not be, loba means, you should not be greedy. Greedy means what? Say some gifts are coming out of the milk ocean. Demons are taking 1, 2, 3, 4. They are taking many gifts. And then Lord Vishnu say he gives 1 or 2 gifts to demigods. Then the tendency is what in this world? To compare. You gave us 2 and they have taken 10. At least you should give us another 4 more. So Lord said don't compare and don't
become greedy. Don't count how many they got, how many you got. You just do the churning or the milk ocean, awaiting the amritam. Like that the Lord is telling them. So these four, five qualities the Lord has told them. The first one he said, patience. Be patient, don't be agitated by anger, and then don't be afraid of the kalakuta, and don't be greedy, don't be angry, don't be lusty. Total of 4 + 2 = 6 instructions God has given. Don't be lusty means what? Lusty means adamantly wanting one of those gifts. Imagine if Indra says, I want that particular gift only. So this is also another thing. Like there was one devotee whose name was little doubtful for initiation. They were thinking whether to send or not send. One devotee was telling, hey, better you send him, otherwise he will be so angry, he will stop coming to temple. They were saying, what kind of devotee is the devotee? If you don't give him initiation, he will stop coming to temple. Then do you think you should give initiation to such a person? Dangerous. Because if you are afraid of such a person, just because he will have ego problem and he will not come, he is not a fit candidate for initiation. So therefore the Lord said, you can't be adamant about things. Actually, ideal disciple for, going for initiation means whatever Guru wishes, whatever Krishna wishes. Ishwar ki Icha, Inshallah, they say, isn't it? Let thy will be done, the Lord's will be done. A disciple should be completely bendable, flexible, adaptable to the desires and will of the Guru. So Lord said, if you guys are saying that you demigods, you love me very much, let me see whether you really love me. If you love me, you should be willing to do whatever I say. I will give all the gifts to demons and no gift to you. Still you should continue the project. That's what he said. And also, Lord wants to actually purify the demigods by giving these instructions. Even we are also like demigods in one sense. Why? Because we have a desire to serve the Lord and we also have some material desires. So demigods also want to serve the Lord and they have material desires. So last time I told you there are three categories of people. Pure devotees only want to serve. And demons only want to enjoy. And what do demigods want to do? They want to serve the Lord also and they want to enjoy also. So the Lord told them, Lord is actually purifying them to come to the point of only serving. Without, protecting one's enjoying mentality. So therefore Lord is giving these wonderful instructions to them. Now Shukadeva Goswami is saying, Shri Shuka Vacha Iti Devan Samadishya Bhagavan Purushottamaha Teshamantar Dadhe Rajan Swachanda Gati Rishwaraha.
Shukadeva Goswami said, continued, O King Parikshit, after advising the demigods in this way, the independent Supreme Personality of Godhead, the best of all living entities, disappeared from their presence.
See, Lord is also one of the living entities, but he is a supreme living entity. And also Lord is said to be independent. Why? See, the word by saying independent, Shukadeva Goswami indirectly is saying the demigods are dependent. Supreme Lord is independent and demigods are dependent. And we are as such dependent on the Supreme Lord, plus we are dependent for one more reason, because we are attached in this world. When we are attached to anything in this world, we become overly dependent also. So even in the three gunas, three modes in this world, so the demigods have their attachments, they have their aspirations, they have their desires, they want their post back, they also want amritam, they want to live long duration of life. They want to defeat the demons. They are fearful of the demons also. They have anxieties in the mind and they have aspirations in the mind, both in the same situation. So Lord understands that these fellows are dependent fellows. They are attached fellows. At the same time, he is giving good instructions to them, to purify them. Read the next translations, 2-3 translations.
Then Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva, after offering their respectful obeisances to the Lord, returned to their abodes. All the demigods then approached Maharaj Bali. Maharaj Bali, a most celebrated king of the demons, knew very well when to make peace and when to fight. Thus, although his commanders and captains were agitated and were about to kill the demigods, Maharaj Bali, seeing that the demigods were coming to him without a militant attitude, forbade his commanders to kill them.
Yeah, see, the kings knew the art of diplomacy in the Vedic times, whom to make friends with and who is the enemy, and in which situation, how to act. So these are all taught in the Arthashastra. Chanakya also teaches these things. For example, sometimes the king who wishes to expand his kingdom will not wage a war against the enemy kingdom. Rather, he will marry the daughter of that king. Then naturally that kingdom comes into this also. He would expand his kingdom by marrying more different dynasty, like for example Dasharatha dynasty. If you find in Krishna's Vrishnis, so there are 6 or 8 dynasties all put together, because they are all friendly dynasties with each other. So the king can also have allies, he can also have enemies. And also one of the reasons for enmity is also one's ideologies. If somebody has a godly ideology, Vedic ideology, and somebody has an atheistic ideology, then naturally they will be enemy kings. On the other hand, when Yudhishthira Maharaj was ruling the world, all over the world many pious kings aligned with him, and they were very happy to pay tribute to the king and stay under his custody, and they were ready to pay tax, they had no problem. So here Bali Maharaj, actually in the third, in the purport, if you see, second line purpose is, when enemies come to their opponent's place.
When enemies come to their opponent's place, they should be received in such a way that they will forget that there is animosity between the two parties. Bali Maharaj was well conversant with the arts of peacemaking and fighting. Thus, he received the demigods very well, although his commanders and captains were agitated. This kind of treatment was prevalent even during the fight between the Pandavas and the Kurus. During the day, the Pandavas and Kurus would fight with the utmost strength, and when the day was over, they would go to each other's camps as friends and be received as such.
It's like sports, isn't it? Of course, I don't know whether the sports, they do that, even nowadays. But in the Vedic wars, which would happen, Prabhupada says, why the Vedic wars would happen? Prabhupada says that, say, imagine in the Vedic times, there is one king ruling one state, for example. Now, why would he wage a war against another state in the neighborhood? Because this king wants to enforce some religious laws on the people, by which all people will become religious and pious and they will follow the God's laws. Whereas the other king is not instituting religious principles down the line. So in order to, therefore, Jarasandha was killed by Pandavas, correct, no? By Bhima. So that Yudhishthira Maharaj can do Rajasuya again. Because Jarasandha was not instituting Vedic Dharma for his people. So then the king would take over his kingdom. Either that king will be finished or the king will surrender. Then, like here, he has a Vedic law. Same Vedic law he will apply there also. Like that, the kings would do. And that way they would expand their kingdom. Expanding kingdom also means expanding Krishna consciousness. Especially if a king is an ideal king. So therefore, Prabhupada says, whenever there was a war, so both kings along with their troops, army troops, can prove to one another who is better. Okay, if you are better than me, then you rule over me and my people and everybody. Or if I am better than you, I will rule and then you take my guidance. And then, but once the war is over during the day, and war also will not happen in the area where civil people would live. It would happen in the outskirts of the country. People, normal life would be going on in the state. There will be no problem. Wars would be happening completely in the outskirts. And in that war also, Prabhupada says here, during the daytime there was war, in the evening time, they would go and meet. Like you all know, Arjuna came to fetch the 5 arrows from Duryodhana. Which means they would meet each other.
You will find in Vritrasura pastime, when Vritrasura was attacking very powerfully, even the demigods cheered him. Jai, Jai, they were saying. And that happens in other places in Bhagavatam also. Even if an enemy has a prowess, like Abhimanyu was very powerful, then all the Kuru race people also clapped hands and cheered him. Which means they never saw that he is our side man or their side man. They would appreciate whoever exhibits very great prowess. So the Vedic war appears to be much different than now. So, like for example, if a messenger comes from the enemy's troop into your troop to give a message, nobody can kill him. Because he is coming to give a message. So this was followed at that time. Even now you will know recently when one of the Indian soldiers, going in a plane, fell on the Pakistan side. You know that? And then he was safely returned back to India and this thing, correct? Because the Prime Minister requested and then it was returned. Even today they follow, you can see that. It's not that they catch him and blackmail India saying that your man is with us, they will trouble him or something. So there are some law codes which they followed. So Bali is a king, but his associates are immature fellows. His associates are very immature fellows. So they were showing their teeth, gritting their teeth and showing animosity when they saw Indra coming. Hey, look at that Indra coming. But they thought he's an enemy. But Bali Maharaj was mature. He said, okay, they're coming in a friendly mood. Let us see what is the proposal. He was willing to listen. Therefore, one requires such maturity in dealing with inimical forces. Otherwise, if people have such externally showing enmity like the associate demons of Bali, then always there will be war. So, Bali could subdue his lower nature and welcome them. Read further, the demigods.
Last two lines.
During such friendly meetings, one enemy would offer anything the other enemy wanted. That was the system.
The next translation.
The demigods approached Bali Maharaj, the son of Virochan, and sat down near him. Bali Maharaj was protected by
the word near him, it is said. That is sitting near means it's a. The word itself indicates its friendliness. The distance was not too much. They are sitting near means they are behaving in a friendly way.
Bali Maharaj was protected by the commanders of the demons and was most opulent, having conquered all the universe.
Mahendrash Lakshnaya Vacha Santvayitva Mahamatihi Abhyabhashatat Sarvam Shikshitam Purushottamat.
After pleasing Bali Maharaj with mild words, Lord Indra, the king of the demigods, who was most intelligent, very politely submitted all the proposals he had learned from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu.
See, this is the best quality of Indra. He has made notes of all the points what Lord Vishnu told. Nabetavyam Kalakutat, Vishad Jalad Sampavat. They heard all that. So because Lord Vishnu has told Indra and other demigods how to approach the demons, how to speak politely, how to submit the proposal for a truce, Samudra Mantra and everything, they exactly presented as Lord Vishnu spoke. So although Indra may have many defects, many problems, he also has a good side of faithfully following Lord Vishnu, Vishnu's order. So he is going to Bali Maharaj and he is presenting the proposals.
Tatparochata daityasya tatranye yesuradhipaha shambaro rishtanemischa ye cha tripuravasinaha.
The proposals submitted by King Indra were immediately accepted by Bali Maharaj and his assistants, headed by Shambara and Arishtanemi, and by all the other residents of Tripura.
The purport is very important purport, isn't it?
It appears from this verse that politics, diplomacy, the propensity to cheat, and everything that we find in this world in individual and social negotiations between two parties are also present in the upper planetary systems.
Yeah, generally we think the upper planetary system like Swarga and all must be very pure. You know, only on Earth there is so much problem, you think. There also these problems are there. Prabhupada is saying there also there is politics, diplomacy, propensity to cheat. Because demigods are also ultimately living beings within this Brahmanda only. Maybe they are more finer, more fine-tuned diplomacy than on Earth. And if you go to the hellish planets, it may be worse actually. But even on the heavenly planets, these problems are there, he says. Only the spiritual world is a place which is completely pure. Yes.
The demigods went to Bali Maharaj with the proposal to manufacture nectar, and the daityas, the demons, immediately accepted it, thinking that since the demigods were already weak, when the nectar was produced, the demons would take it from them and use it for their own purposes. The demigods, of course, had similar intentions. The only difference is that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu, was on the side of the demigods because the demigods were his devotees, whereas the demons did not care about Lord Vishnu. All over the universe, there are two parties, the Vishnu party or the God-conscious party and the godless party. The godless party is never happy or victorious, but the God-conscious party is always happy and victorious.
See, here is a very important point. One Mataji wrote a letter to Prabhupada saying that, Swamiji, two of your disciples were distributing books and I found them very forceful in distributing the books. So this is very indecent behavior which cannot be tolerated. You should properly instruct them. Like that she wrote a letter. I read about this in the SSR book, in Science of Self-Realization, you will find it. And Prabhupada replied her back saying that, thank you for your letter, but let me tell you, they are engaged in Lord's service. Maybe they were a little forceful in giving the book, but actually they are giving out medicines for curing the diseased living entities. So they are doing a very great service. You are criticizing them that they are pushing the books, but what are you doing for God? Prabhupada challenged her. So we also as devotees should learn to see that even though some devotees may have certain defects, despite the defects, we should remember that they are engaged in Lord's service. Some devotee may be angry, some devotee may be greedy for Mahaprasad, some devotee may be pushy in distributing books. Sometimes a devotee's behavior is not standard up to the mark. But we should know there is a big gulf of difference between non-devotees and semi-baked devotees. You know, non-devotees are, in that sense, non-devotees are doing nothing for the Lord. These semi-baked devotees, you know, they may be immature in their behavior, speech or dealing. They may not be so gentlemanly, but at least they are engaged in Lord's service. Similarly, here it is said the demons and demigods both had similar intentions. Demons thought we will cheat demigods and take amritam. And demigods thought we will take amritam and drive away the demons. But the good side is appreciated because demigods were aligned with Lord Vishnu. They were ready to follow the order of Lord Vishnu. That's what makes them glorious. Because in conditioned stage, even all of us have some defect or the other. We sometimes don't do the services perfectly. You have seen some devotees have an escaping mentality from service. We call escaping mentality means escaping from mercy. Escaping service means escaping mercy. But there's similarly, some devotees, if you give them service, they will think, will my name come or not? If my name won't come, then I won't want the service. These are all defects in the service. Greedy for name, fame, glory. Or somebody will ask, okay, Prabhu, I'll do this service. What will you give me in return? At least 2 gulab jamuns, isn't it? So we have certain expectation of fruits, expectation of name, expectation of recognition. Or sometimes, therefore, sometimes people, if you want to get a big service done, I've seen Gauranga Prabhu used to tell them, at the end of your service, Maharaj will come to see all of you. Hari Bol, now we will do the service. So, because everybody is, so in our defect, in our condition stage, we all are devotees, but our devotional service is also accompanied by certain defects. But what happens with certain devotees, when they see the other devotees showing defect, they become extremely angry and envious towards them. Outside people can be bad. How can devotee be bad like this? They ask like that. You know? Prabhuji, outside person can be selfish. How you are a devotee, how you can be selfish? So they become extremely averse to devotees, extremely angry towards devotees. And due to that, due to the offense, they don't get taste in the chanting of the holy name. Therefore, one should look at the devotees with a sympathetic eye. You should think that, after all, they are engaged in Krishna service. They may have defects. See, which is good? Being a conditioned soul and having defect, or being a conditioned soul having defect and engaged in Krishna service, which is better? Second is better or first better? Second, isn't it? Yeah. So we should not become extremely upset with devotees showing defects. Somehow, some devotees told me that, Prabhu, when devotees show defect, I become 10 times more angry. One devotee said, devotees are supposed to be perfect. They should not misrepresent the movement. It's all right. But here you can see, Lord was very well aware that devotees are also similar to demons. They had similar mentality. Demigods also wanted to get the Amritam without giving to demons. But Lord in mind, because they were following Brahminical culture, they were following the orders of Vishnu. So Vishnu accepted them without becoming averse to them. Because as long as you are conditioned soul, the defects will linger in us. And as gradually you will get purified. And then he's saying, Tato deva sura kritva samvidam krita sauhridaha udyamam paramam chakrur amritarthe parantapa.
O Maharaj Parikshit, chastiser of enemies.
Actually, one example comes to my mind. There was one devotee in a temple. He was a brahmacharya temple. So there was one foreign lady who was also coming to the community. So this brahmacharya became attracted to her. Although he was a saffron brahmachari, and then some people are talking, everybody is talking and all. Finally, he got down, he turned to white, and then he married her. But still, a lot of people criticized him. He's in Maya. He fell down with a foreign lady and everything. So their spiritual master told them that actually, see, he has moved out of the ashrama and he is marrying her and he is settling and he wants to continue serving in ISKCON forever. He is going to continue serving. So you should see that at least he wishes to serve Krishna. He is not eloping with her somewhere else to go to some Shimla or Nainital or anywhere to enjoy honeymoon or something. He is right here. He has married her properly. He is not hanging around with her. He is marrying her properly. And he is also... So these two things Guru told them to see. See that he is properly marrying her and he is taking responsibility for her life. And if he begets children, then he will raise the children also. He is bringing money home. Another thing is, he is continuing to engage in his devotional service. He is not giving up bhakti. He is not giving up chanting. Still he is wearing tilak, kantimala, white and white he is wearing. And he has a wife now. He is a grihastha man now. So Guru told them that try to see the brighter side of his life. Maybe his lower nature or conditionings made him become attracted to a woman. At the right time he got warning calls and everything, and then he was married now and he settled now. But generally what happens, those devotees who are themselves neophytes and immature, they will not catch the right side. They will catch the negative side. Hey, I told you it's a foreign lady. She came and she was always after him. He was always after her. I know, I told you. They will keep on talking. And they will never get taste in chanting. When they take the beat back also, the same thought will come. Same thought will keep on clouding their mind. Therefore, we should learn from this. When demigods have defects, but their glory is they want to serve Lord Vishnu. They want to serve Vishnu's instruction. So therefore, if we don't capture this understanding, we will become offensive. If you don't capture this good understanding. So therefore, the glory of a person is that he is engaged in Lord's service. That is the glory. The conditionings are always there in this world, whether you are a devotee or not a devotee. And it's not that a person showing lower nature conditioning should not be punished. The justice should be given wherever necessary. But the point that you are making here is, learn to see a jiva engaged in Lord's service, obedient to the Lord, serving the Lord, rightly situated. Those things should be seen. Read further.
The demigods and the demons thereafter made an armistice between them. Then with great enterprise they engaged...
No, they arranged.
They arranged to produce nectar as proposed by Lord Indra.
Yeah. Yeah. 33rd verse.
Tataste mandaragirim ojasot patya durmadaha nandan nadanta udadhim ninyuhu shakta parigabhahavaha.
Yeah.
Thereafter, with great strength, the demons and demigods, who were all very powerful and who had long stout arms, uprooted Mandara mountain.
It's a special effect. Uprooting the Mandara mountain, yeah. Yeah.
Crying very loudly, they brought it toward the ocean of milk.
Yeah. See, why they were crying loudly? It was very heavy. Huh? They were finding it very difficult to lift. Demigods and demons with great difficulty. The picture is there. If you have the book with you, you will see the huge mountain they were lifting. Yeah. Later on, Lord Vishnu is lifting it. Now Lord Vishnu is lifting, but before that they were lifting. Very heavy, huge mountain. So they were all, like you will see the people who, when they lift an object, they chant some slogans, you have seen, no? Dham hag, dham laga ke hissa, dham laga ke hissa, they shout, no? Of course, our Radha Gopinath Prabhu says this, and he says, our mantra is Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare. So, they are lifting the mountain and bringing, but what happens? Read the 34th one.
Because of conveying the great mountain for a long distance, King Indra, Bali Maharaj and the other demigods and demons became fatigued. Being unable to carry the mountain, they left it on the way.
Yeah. Like we lift the Balaji's palanquin. So some people will be just touching it without actually lifting it. You have seen that? Because they think it's a holy thing, so at least touch it. So the actual lifting people say, hey, get out. Either you lift it or you quit. Don't just make a show of lifting, they would say. No? And it's sometimes very heavy. You will see in South India, in Tirupati Balaji Temple, Brahmotsavam, if you go and lift that palki, you will see there will be 20 people lifting practically. Pretty, very heavy. So here also all of them are lifting the mountain. When it became very heavy, it slipped out of their hands. Nipatansa girestatra
bahu namaradana van churnayam asamahata bharena kanakachalah.
See, nipatan, it is at the mountain, slipped out of their hands and fell down. Giri tatra, on that spot. Then what happened? Bahun, amara danavan. Many demigods and demons. What happened? Churnayamasa, it is a churnam. You know churnam? Churna you make. Like that, their hands and legs were churnam, smashed by the mountain. It is a mahata. Mahata bharena, that big mountain's weight. Kanaka achalaha, the golden mountain. Mandara fell to the ground, and many of their legs got stuck, hands got stuck, and some of them lost their hands and legs. At that time, Lord Vishnu took pity on them.
Tamstata bhagna manaso bhagna bahuru kandharan vignaya bhagamamstatra babhuva garuda dvajaha.
Yeah.
The demigods and demons were frustrated and disheartened, and their arms, thighs and shoulders were broken. Therefore, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who knows everything, appeared there on the back of his carrier, Garuda.
See, some people said bhagna bahu, bhagna uru. Uru is the thigh, bahu is the hand. So those guys who lost their hands and legs were worried about their hands and legs. But those guys who slipped out and they didn't break their heads, they had bhagna manasa. They were broken hearted. Alas, we couldn't take the mountain up to the ocean of milk. So both are bhagna, bhagna manas and bhagna bahu, bhagna uru, they said.
Giripata vinishpishtan vilokyamaradanavan ikshaya jivayamasa nirjaran nirvranan yatha
Observing that most of the demons and the demigods had been crushed by the falling of the mountain, the Lord glanced over them and brought them back to life.
Just see the power of the Lord's glance. Simply by glancing at them, he brought them all back to life, and also the hands which were churnam, that came back again. Legs also. Lord Vishnu's glance is very powerful.
Thus they became free from grief, and they even had no bruises on their bodies.
Even bruises were not there. Nobody even knew which hand actually got smashed. This hand or this hand. Both hands looked normal actually. Not even a scratch, he is saying. So, therefore we come in front of the deities to take their darshan, because when the deities look at their devotees, all our defects and deficiencies are nullified. Therefore we take darshan. That is the mood in which we should take darshan also. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur used to say, Lord is the drashta. Drashta means the seer. We are not the seer. Who is the seer? Lord is the seer. We are actually seen. Lord is the seer. Seer means when you stand in front of the deities, Lord is watching you, not that we are watching him. Now you may say, Prabhuji, are we also not watching? We are actually not watching. Why? Because we can't see him the way we should be seeing. Actually, we should see him with eyes of love. Do we have eyes of love? No. So therefore our seeing is not seeing at all. But he is seeing us with love. He is a Suhridam Sarva Bhutana. Therefore we should know, let Lord see me, let him cure my deficiencies and ill motivations and defects and make me spotless. That we can look at the Lord with that consciousness. I read the next one verse. Translation.
The Lord very easily lifted the mountain with one hand and placed it on the back of Garuda. Then he too got on the back of Garuda and went to the ocean of milk, surrounded by the demigods and demons.
See the power of Garuda. Lord put the mountain on Garuda's back with one hand. Just like that, Lord lifted with one hand, put it on the top of Garuda, and he also sat on Garuda's top. And not only that, it's also mentioned surrounded by the demigods and demons. He carried them also. All of them flew to the ocean. That is the power of Garuda, you see. Read the purport of Prabhupada.
Here is proof of the omnipotence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is above everyone. There are two classes of living entities.
See, there are three words: omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient. Omnipotent means extremely powerful Lord. Balavan, Viryavan, that's the word used. Like he creates millions of universes from his body. He is omnipotent. And omnipresent means Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. He is present in every Brahmanda. He is omni. Garbhodakshaya Vishnu is the soul of every Brahmanda. And Mahavishnu creates all the Brahmandas. And Kshirodakshaya Vishnu is the super soul in our hearts of everybody. So now Garbhodakshaya Vishnu is called omnipresent. And Kshirodakshaya Vishnu is omniscient. Omniscient means what? Knowing, all knowing. Yeah. Because Paramatma knows everything. So three lords: omnipotent, omnipresent, omniscient. Mahavishnu, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu, Kshirodakshaya Vishnu. So in this way he is saying Lord is omnipotent. How powerful he is. He can lift the Garuda he can lift the mountain and put on back of Garuda, sit on the back and take all demigods and demons with him. Go ahead.
There are two classes of living entities, the demons and the demigods, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead is above them both. The demons believe in the chance theory of creation, whereas the demigods believe in creation by the hand of the Supreme Personality of Godhead.
Yeah. Go ahead.
The omnipotence of the Supreme Lord is proved here, for simply with one hand he lifted Mandara mountain, the demigods and demons placed them on the back of Garuda, and brought them to the ocean of milk. Now the demigods, the devotees, would immediately accept this incident, knowing that the Lord can lift anything, however heavy it may be. But although demons were also carried along with the demigods, the demons upon hearing of this incident would say that it is mythological.
See, Prabhupada is saying, Lord carried on the wings of Garuda both demons and demigods with him, along with Mandara Parvati. He himself was sitting. And all of them went to the milk ocean. Still demons will call it mythological, he says. Actually, how to understand what Prabhupada is saying here? You see, once Prabhupada was making this point. If a man would bark like a dog, doing mimicry, big crowd of people would come to watch. Is it not true? But dog is, God already has made millions of dogs bark. But nobody is admiring it. You know why? Because Lord's creation has gone beyond the extraordinary imagination of man. So much he has done. He is making huge sun float in the sky. He is making millions of planets and stars float in the sky. He is arranging for the ocean water to be converted into rain water. He is creating grains and fruits and so many things. So Lord is doing miracle at every moment all around us. It requires only an eye of wonderment to see it and recognize it, appreciate it, and be honest about it, and glorify it and worship it. But actually demons have a different type of eye, because their eyes always tends to think that everything in this world is meant for our enjoyment, and it is all existing by chance. So therefore you will see, like when in this world nothing exists without a creator or without a purpose. Like you see this bulb, some company has created it and it exists for the purpose of giving light. Take a fan, ketan or something. So some company has produced it and it exists for the purpose of giving wind. Is it not true? Everything exists for a certain purpose and is created by, like Reynolds pen, made by the Reynolds company, and it exists for the purpose of writing. Similarly, look at the world around you. Somebody says, who created it? Oh, it came by chance. Why does it exist? Just like that it is existing. No. Nothing can exist without a purpose. Everything has a purpose. Or maybe you don't know the purpose. That is your problem, not God's problem. God has created everything with a purpose. So what is the purpose of this world? The purpose of this world is reformation, or cleansing of our heart. It's a jail. The jail is meant for bringing thieves to become gentlemen. So this material world is created for cleaning our heart and going back to God. That's the purpose. And it's created by Lord with from the subtlest element of sound vibration. You will see, you will find Pradhan, then Mahatattva, Pradhan and Prakriti and Mahatattva, and then when all the Sattvika Ahankar, Rajasika Ahankar, Tamasika Ahankar, then the Indriyas are created, Man is created, Tanmatras are created, then gradually the sound, then the sound, the water, then the fire, then air and the earth. Eventually you will find gradual deduction of all these items. What you see in this world is the grossest thing, earth. So you can study Sankhya, which will elaborately explain about how this whole world was created in a very scientific manner. You will find, for example, one element is contained in the other. You will find, for example, earth also has fragrance. You will find like that. Like that, the water also has taste. Similarly, the fire also has form. So you will study in the Sankhya how Kapila explains it very thoroughly. So if somebody has any doubts whether this creation came on its own or somebody created it, then we should study Sankhya, very elaborately it gives. So therefore Prabhupada says here, the nature of devotees is to have very simple faith. Just like you all know the cobbler and the brahmana. Cobbler's faith was very simple. He had faith that Lord Vishnu can put an elephant inside the hole of a needle. But brahmana couldn't believe it because he thought he is too educated. You will find the cobbler's logic was very simple. You know what the cobbler said? The cobbler said, if such a big banyan tree can be put inside a small seed, why can't the Lord put an elephant in a needle hole? Correct, no? So in the same manner, Prabhupada's logic is all very easy to understand. One lecture conversation I was reading, Prabhupada says, look at this coconut water, how tasty it is. And devotee said, yes, Prabhupada. And then Prabhupada said, you see, if you want to send water from the ground to the syntax tank, what do you need? What do you need? Motor. Now, how is the groundwater lifted up and it is put inside the coconut? So much water is put. Where is the pump? Think about it. You can use many, many terms, reverse osmosis. So many words you may use. But how is the water sent there? Okay, why don't you use osmosis to pump all your water? Why don't you do that? No? You see, you need a pump to put the water. Not only the water from the ground is taken to such a altitude of a coconut tree, it is also turned into sweet water. Correct, no? Salt water is turned into sweet water. If you have a pump, will the pump turn salt water into sweet water? Because it's made by us, that's why it cannot do it. But it's made by God, the coconut water is made by God, so He can convert salt water into sweet water and He can elevate it to such a height without the use of a pump. So when a devotee sees this, oh, Lord is wonderful. How wonderful the Lord is. He has done many such things. Look at each flower, see the petals of a flower, the fragrance of a flower, the beauty of a flower. Whereas you look at a plastic flower, it has no fragrance. If you touch a plastic flower, it is so rough, isn't it? It has no tenderness. Similarly, look at a real mango and a plastic mango. Plastic mango you can keep in your showcase in your house. You know people keep plastic mango? Nobody should open the glass door and pick and see it. If you try to bite it, you will not get any taste. Therefore one has to, devotees of the Lord can very naturally and very easily and immediately accept that Lord is wonderful, His creation is wonderful. He is doing miracles. Prabhupada says, not only Lord does miracle, even the Jiva can do miracles. Further, he gives example that first understand, don't understand God first, understand yourself. Therefore, we say discover yourself. You will see that even a Jiva has Achintya Shakti. For example, the body of a cow is able to produce milk. A woman, when she begets a child, immediately her mammary glands are able to produce milk for the baby. Isn't it? Similarly, Prabhupada says, we are producing stool, which is hydrogen phosphate, which has a very powerful nourishing tendency. Therefore, the pigs are very fat by eating their stool. So, we are producing through our Achintya Shakti many things from our body, even without our knowledge, Prabhupada is saying. For example, your hair is growing. Even without your knowledge, hair grows longer and longer. Nails are growing. You will see that. Milk is coming out of the body, similarly the stool, similarly the urine. These are all due to Achintya Shakti in the soul. These are all produced like this. Like a bird is able to fly. Bird doesn't even know how he is able to fly. It's one of the Achintya Shakti of the soul to be able to fly. In a bird's body, the flying avenue is open. In a human body, the flying avenue is locked up. That avenue is locked. But there are other avenues open, like intelligence is awakened. So, Atma also has multiple Achintya Shaktis. In each body, some of them are suppressed, some of them are released. Like that, Prabhupada explains. So after seeing your own self, you look at God, He has ocean of Achintya Shaktis. You can create some little sweat while sleeping at night, but Lord can produce a Pacific Ocean or Atlantic Ocean, He says. Vast ocean He can produce. He can produce a dome light, but Lord can produce a moonlight. You can produce a mercury bulb, Lord can produce a sun. You can produce a swimming pool in your house. Lord can produce Atlantic Ocean. So whatever you can do in a small way, Lord can do in a big way. So I had written a poem for the Discover Yourself, session 4. I am a tiny jiva, not the ultimate Lord, but a tiny part and parcel, a servant of the Lord. Like there's a song. So very sweetly I am smashing Mayavad in that song. If anybody sings a song, a Mayavadi will forget Mayavad philosophy. So, there we are writing, God made the sunlight, God made the moonlight, we make the dome light. Like that. So, if you have a very natural respect and faith in the Lord, you are very fortunate. If you don't have, I would suggest that you should read books by our Richard L. Thompson, Sadaputta Prabhu. He has a whole website now available. You should go and he's one of the most world renowned scientists, even in Karmi circles, not only in devotees. He actually flabbergasted the scientists, are flabbergasted by his presentations in his times. Even today he is being talked about. He is no more on the planet now, but his whole books, more than 25 books he has written, and more than 100-200 articles are also there in his website, Sadaputa Prabhu. Then you can also read Michael Cremo, and such kinds of people, great scientists. In order for us to, you know, understand, even great scientists are admiring the Lord's omnipotence. Read further, finish.
But if God is all-powerful, why would it be difficult for him to lift a mountain? Since he is floating innumerable planets with many hundreds and thousands of Mandara mountains, why can't he lift one of them with his hand? This is not mythology, but the difference between the believers and the faithless is that the devotees accept the incidents mentioned in the Vedic literatures to be true, whereas the demons simply argue and label all these historical incidents mythology. Demons would prefer to explain
that... This is called Ashraddha Dhana. Ashraddha Dhana means one who may read the Puranas but will not put faith in them. Yeah.
Demons would prefer to explain that everything happening in the cosmic manifestation takes place by chance. But demigods or devotees never consider anything to be chance. Rather, they know that everything is an arrangement of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is the difference between the demigods and the demons.
Avaropyagirim skhandat suparna patatam varaha yayau jalant utsrajya harinasa visarjitah.
Thereafter, Garuda, the chief of birds, unloaded Mandara mountain from his shoulder and brought it near the water. Then he was asked by the Lord to leave that place, and he left.
Purport.
Garuda was asked by the Lord to leave that place because the snake Vasuki, who was to be used as the rope for the churning, would not go there in the presence of Garuda. Garuda, the carrier of Lord Vishnu, is not a vegetarian. He eats big snakes. Vasuki, being a great snake, would be natural food for Garuda, the chief of the birds. Lord Vishnu therefore asked Garuda to leave so that Vasuki would be brought to churn the ocean with Mandara mountain, which was to be used as the churning rod. These are the wonderful arrangements of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Nothing takes place by accident.
Okay, now I had a question to my spiritual master about this. Of course, one devotee asked the question that how can Garuda eat fishes? He's a Krishna's devotee. He did only prasadam. You know, one devotee was asking. So Maharaj was telling in Bombay, I heard the lecture. Maharaj was telling that actually Garuda is a bird. He's like an eagle. And the eagle's natural food is, you know, fishes or snakes and fruits also. They eat that also. So Maharaj said he has been sanctioned especially by Lord Vishnu. Eat that. And as humans, we cannot imitate. There are certain jati people like our Guha, for example, eats fishes or certain type of thing. They are called Nishadas. But he was a great devotee of Lord Rama. So some of them may be belonging to Anteja class. Still, they may be devotees. For that matter, in first canto of Bhagavatam, we find in Dwaraka, there were some even prostitutes who were actually great devotees of the Lord. By will of providence, they were born in certain type of body where they were in such a situation. But actually, they were devotees of the Lord. So, which means devotees of the Lord are all over the world in all kinds of classes. So, he said. Now, the second question I had was, why did Lord tell Garuda, Vasuki, when he was brought, he told Garuda to immediately go away? Because Garuda was son of Vinata and Vasuki was son of Kadru. And Kadru is a snake race and Vinata is the bird race. They both have an enmity. I will not go into the story, it's a very long story. But they had enmity. That means two people can be Lord's devotees, but they may have enmity. So I asked my spiritual master that, I personally asked him, I didn't ask in a class, it's a little delicate question. I asked him, Maharaj, can there be two disciples who have a terrible fight among themselves, but they both are disciples of same Guru? So Maharaj then answered, You shouldn't think that Vasuki and Garuda have a big fight. Vasuki just needed a breathing space, that's all. Like that he said. That was the answer. He said Vasuki needed breathing space. Because in the presence of Garuda, he will feel little uneasy. Because Garuda may eat. If you see Garuda, big deity of Garuda is there in South India. You have seen that? He has got snake here, everywhere is wearing snakes like armor because he is conqueror of snakes. So therefore, our Vasuki cannot peacefully do his job in the presence of Garuda. So therefore, Lord told Garuda, you carry on with your other services. Like that Lord, he told him. And then Maharaj said that amongst devotees, sometimes certain two devotees' chemistry may not match. We shouldn't think they are quarreling. We can just understand that their natures are different. So they can serve in two different departments. But if you put them in the same department, there will be explosion. So we have completed this chapter. Next class we meet, we will talk about Lord Shiva drinking halahal. Very important chapter. Parama Vaishnava. Most compassionate Vaishnava Shiva. So we will read that and proceed with the appearance of Lord Dhanvantri with the Kalash. Mantraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki. You can see how much relevant Lord Vishnu's instructions are to our lives also. Bhagavatam is very amazing, both in terms of, sanctifying our minds by giving us information about Lord's pastimes and also giving us something down to earth, very practical.